Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God, and it is he that hath made us, not we ourselves. Let's give God a hand of praise this morning. We will ask that you stand for our call to worship. Psalms 145, verses 1 through 7, ESV. After it, we'll have a selection led by Brother Benjamin Bryant. Call to worship. Let us begin. I will extol you, my God and King, and I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. And I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your goodness and shall sing aloud your righteousness. Amen. Near the cross.
Thank you.
led by Brother Jeffrey Cooper in prayer.
Everyone bowed our heads. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us together to hear your word, to be together as one. Through this pandemic, we have had to be 6 feet apart, but thank you for letting us be under this one house together. To hear our pastor tell us and show us the word that you have given him. Thank you, Lord, for letting us be able to wake up this morning on this beautiful Sunday and be able to come worship you, because without you, we would not be here. And Lord, knowing that we have students going back to school, I want you to pray that we do not have any COVID cases with our students or any student, because we want everyone to be safe. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Jehovah Jireh, my provider, you are more than enough for me. Jehovah Rapha, you're my set free. Jehovah Shammah, you are with me. You supply all my needs. You're more than enough. You're more than enough. You are more than enough for me. Jehovah Jireh, my Jehovah Rapha, you're my healer. By your stripes, I have been set free. Jehovah Shammah, you are with me. You supply all my
you. That's Sister Janet Griffin. Amen. And we are so thankful for our music ministry and the effort they put forth so that we can offer up these praises to our God. Amen. Amen. What an awesome God. What an awesome God that we serve. Heavenly Father, we know that your Spirit does the work. Your Spirit produces the fruit. And so we continue to pray that your Spirit will teach us and transform us into the image of Christ as we open your word together in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. This morning I want to talk about a strategy for troubled times. How is it that a nation gets through troubled times? We need to know how to get through these times that we're facing as a nation. And so I went to the book of Judges, led there by God's Spirit, who revealed that we're not the first nation to face trouble. Matter of fact, the nation of Israel faced trouble time and time again. And then I looked at one particular moment in the nation's history when God delivered them. And I saw a strategy there that I love to share with you this morning from Judges chapter 5, 3 verses. Then sang Deborah and Barak, son of Abinoam, on that day, saying, "For the leaders who took the lead in Israel, for the people who offered themselves willingly, bless the Lord. Hear, O kings, give ear, O princes. I will sing to the Lord. I will sing praise to the Lord, the God of Israel." Then sang Deborah and Barak. Then, an adverb of time. They didn't sing until something else happened. Matter of fact, they were singing because something else happened. What happened? Well, the nation was in trouble. And as was the pattern for the nation of Israel, they would do evil in the sight of the Lord. And God would visit them and bring judgment. He would bring divine discipline upon the nation. Usually it would come in one of three ways. The sword, meaning another nation would come and conquer them, defeat them, carry them off. If not the sword, famine, lack of a resource, most times food or water. And then there was a pestilence. The pestilence was a plague, an infectious disease that spread throughout the nation, killing thousands of people. And so God would judge them. He would place them under divine discipline, and they cry out to God. And God would send a judge, a leader in this time called the judges. Do you know a nation that time and time again, God blesses the nation and the nation just keeps on doing evil? I mean, God, and I know a nation that has a song, and the song tells how God blesses the nation, but the nation keeps on doing evil. And so now here we are. It's not the sword, it's not the famine, but I do believe we're in a pestilence. It's a troublesome pestilence, a plague. In our text, it was the sword. It was the king of Canaan, Jabin, who had a general named Sisera. Sisera had 900 chariots of iron, meaning he had a superior army. And so he attacked Israel and oppressed the nation of Israel for 20 years, two decades. They're in this situation because they kept on doing evil. Are you still with me? But then enter Deborah, the prophetess. Deborah is a female leader in a male-dominated society. Enter Deborah, the prophetess. She's a leader indeed. For chapter 4, in the context, we read that she had a place where she would sit. They call it the palm of Deborah. She would sit and judge the nation. She was an established, honorable, effective leader in Israel. A female leader in a male-dominated society. Israel, as a nation, was a patriarchal nation, meaning that it was a male-led nation. If it was matriarchal, then it would be a female-led nation. So Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are called the patriarchs. I remember a time in the history of our people, African-American people, that their families that were matriarchal. There was a strong female presence. Grandmother, great-grandmother, a great-great-grandmother. She was the oldest, but she was strong. She was wise. She had wisdom. She had experience. And she was called a matriarch of the family, the backbone of the family. And most of our families, we called her Big Mama. And everybody, when they came from wherever they would come from, they went to Big Mama house. And Big Mama would lay out a spread, yes. And if you were thinking of getting married, you made sure that you would go by Big Mama house and say, Big Mama, this is my friend. And then later you come back by yourself and say, Big Mama, what did you think of my friend? And Big Mama would let you know, baby, you need to keep looking. Yeah. A Big Mama would say, well, he's all right. You know, but you wouldn't know whether he received or she received Big Mama's approval. That's a matriarchal society, or rather a matriarchal family. And so what I'm saying is, God, in the history of the nation of Israel, he inserts Deborah, a female leader in a male-dominated society, a patriarchal society, to let us know that God views us both male and female as equal in essence, in worth, in value, yet different in role and function. And God determines the role. God determines the function. He does that. And in our text, God has Deborah set up to lead in the nation. I know she's in charge because she summoned Barak. Barak is the military leader for Israel. And the text says she summoned him. Have you ever been summoned? Don't answer. But if you get enough traffic tickets and you don't pay them, you will get a summons. And you don't ignore summons, or you will have a pickup order. Do I have a church? So we know that Deborah has authority. She's a leader. She's effective. She summons Barak, and Deborah knows what God has already said to Barak. Barak is the male leader of the army, but he's sitting around. He hadn't done anything. Deborah says, why are you here? Hasn't God already told you to take your army and go face Sisera and his 900 iron chariots? Yes, he has a superior army, but God is with you. God is going to give you the victory. You have to have faith to go out there, but God is going to give you the victory. So Deborah says, why are you still here? You know what Barak said to Deborah? You read chapter 4 of Judges. Barak says, I'll go if you go with me. But if you won't go with me, I'm not going. Well, wait a minute. Israel is a patriarchal society. It's male-led. Here's Deborah. God inserts Deborah there so we'll know that he values female leadership. Are you still with me? And so Deborah says to Barak, I'll go, but if I go, you won't get any glory out of the battle. The glory will go to a woman. She understands. It's a patriarchal society. She understands that if he does what God told him to do, he will be honored in the victory. But yet he says, I won't go unless you go. What's going on there? Well, one, God has already spoken to Barak, but he hadn't done anything. He hadn't moved. Listen, there are times God speaks to you and I and we don't move. We don't like what God said. Do I have a church? And so we come up with reasons why not to do what God has put on our heart to do. God has directed us to do. He has verified, certified that we ought to do whatever it is. But yet, here we are, sitting around, dragging our feet. Barak was dragging his feet. But he said to Deborah, I'll go if you go. I believe because he saw in Deborah something lacking in himself. He looked at Deborah and saw her relationship with God because she already knew what God had told him. Do I have a church? And so he understands this lady, this woman, she has a relationship with God. She's much closer to God than I am. I'm not going unless she, because if she go, God will be with her at least. Are you still with me? Listen, there's a message there. There's a message there for us. Whatever society that we're in, listen, it's all right, brethren, to lean on the strength of a godly woman. Do I have a church this morning? There are so many times in a marriage where things don't go as well as they could because the brethren are not willing to lean on the strength of a godly woman. Now, I did say a godly woman. Do I have a church? God has placed men and women together in marriage so that, watch this, we can become one. And it works when we lean on each other's strength. Yes, I can lean on Virginia's strength. She can lean on my strength. And together we are one. We are strong. So Deborah goes with Barak. They face the army. Sisera comes out with his 900 chariots. He's defeated. He runs off. And he happens to run up on a tent where there's another woman. Her name is Jael. And Jael is in the tent and she comes out. She sees Sisera, recognizes him as the great general of the Canaanite army. And she says, come into my tent, my lord. Take a rest. Are you running from Barak? Get up under the rug on my tent and I'll hide you there. And he said, listen, if anybody come looking for me, tell them that there's no one in the tent. Yes, my lord. May I have a drink of water, please? She gives him some milk, probably goat milk. you know, because they didn't have no refrigerator, so it had to be, you know, some goat. But at any rate, he goes to sleep, Jael, the woman, in a male-dominated society. She takes a tent peg, a long nail, and a hammer, and while he's sleeping, she approaches him and nails his head to the ground. So when Barak shows up looking for the general, Jael, the woman in a male-dominated society, she walks out and she says, I know who you're looking for, but I got him nailed in here. And as Deborah said, I'll go with you, but you will not receive any glory in this journey. The glory will go to a woman, and she understands it's a male-dominated society, but God uses all of us. So here's the strategy for a nation that's troubled like Israel. For a nation during troubling times, one, the leaders must step up. Yes, Barak was a leader, but he hadn't stepped up. Barak was a leader of the army, but he was still hanging around under the tree. Hadn't moved. God had spoke, but he had not moved. Leaders must step up in times of trouble. If the country's in trouble, the leadership should step up. I don't care if you're a Democrat, a Republican, or whatever. When the country's in trouble, when our nation has a democracy that's about to crumble, then you forget about partisan politics. And you step up. And you be a patriot instead of a politician. You have integrity, honesty, forthrightness, and you do what's right for the nation, for everybody, regardless of color, creed, where you come from, where you grew up. The leaders have to step up. Yes, if it's your community and your community's in trouble, leaders must step up. Work together, problem solve together, find answers, find out how can we stop our children from killing each other. Leaders have to step up. What if it's your church and it's a troubled time? If you're a leader, you step up. Yes, you step up. Why? Because whenever leaders fail to step up, God always has a Deborah willing to step in. God always has somebody, regardless of who they are, they're willing to trust God and step in and fill the void in leadership. So leaders must step up, but then the people must offer up. That's what the text says. It says, for the leaders who took the lead in Israel, for the people who offered themselves willingly. Yes, they offered themselves, here's that word, willingly, not reluctantly, not grudgingly, but the people offered themselves willingly. In other words, you can be a leader, but if nobody's following you. Are you still with me? Yeah, well, if you're a leader, then you have to inspire fellowship. And the people have to willingly follow. You know what? Someone once said that you have not led until somebody follows. And more importantly, until God's agenda has been achieved. Not your agenda, not my agenda, but God's agenda. And so the people willingly offered. What did they willingly offer? All that they were and all that they had. And listen, you may feel like I don't have much to offer. Well, whatever you do have, be willing to offer that. whatever it is. Be willing to offer that. It may be some time. It may be whatever it is, but have a willing spirit. Don't sit back and watch things happen to the community, to the church, to the nation. Don't sit back and say, well, I just won't vote. They made it so hard to vote, I just won't vote. No, if you've got to go down and jump through five hoops and roll over twice to vote, do it. Because somebody's counting on you being discouraged enough, uncomfortable enough, tired enough to not be willing to vote. And we need to vote. Are you still with me? Leaders must step up. The people must offer up. Finally, everybody must look up. Everybody. For the leaders who took the lead in Israel, for the people who offered themselves willingly, bless the Lord. That word bless in the text is barah. It means to bend the knee. To bend the knee, to kneel before God in adoration of who he is and all that he has done. God had given them the victory. The battle had been fought. The victory had been won. They didn't go home before they gave God some praise. They didn't go home before they put together a praise song. And Deborah and Barak got together and they said, we need to worship God. We need to Barak. So they bent their knees and they raised their hands and they offered up praise to God. They said, bless the Lord. And listen, there are times when you need to just bless him. I don't care what's going on. I don't care how many bills you have to pay, what somebody else said about you. You just need to bless the Lord. You got up and you didn't feel good. Bless the Lord. You looked out the window and you had a flat tire. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Because when praises go up, blessings come down. And what we must keep in the midst of this pestilence is a spirit of praise. The body of Christ, the people of God. We must keep a spirit of praise. We must not allow our praises to become sour and stagnant. And worse, silent. Because we're so focused on the 900 chariots of somebody God has already defeated. Listen, leaders, step up. People, offer up. Everybody, bless the Lord. Oh, my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Maybe you're here today having heard the gospel preach. You're ready to respond. If you have not received Christ as Savior, you can do so. You can do so today. In just a moment, we'll give you an opportunity to do so. And maybe you hear, you know Christ as Savior, but you're not connected to a local church, a place where the gifts and abilities he pours into us upon salvation can overflow in ministry to others. If that's you, as we stand, will you come? If that's you, will you come?
Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now. Just now. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now.
Praise God. Praise God. Our offertory boxes are available around the sanctuary. I hope you have made use of them. already if you needed to. If not, immediately after service, please visit one of them. We will now have our offertory prayer coming from. Is that Kenan? All right.
Everybody bow their heads.
Leave him alone. Let him pray. Y'all so bad.
Father God, we thank you for everybody who came here to give today, and we thank you for everybody who wanted to give but couldn't give due to financial situations. We thank you for our pastor, and we thank you for the beautiful service that we had today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen, 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 amen. Thank you so much. Amen, amen. All right. All right. Oh, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. All right, all right. I was liking his voice, too. I like that. I kind of had a little Barry White Isaac Hayes touch to it, you know. He doesn't have a clue who any of those folk are, but he will Google it later. Amen. All right. All right. I was trying to look and see. Well, let me do that. Do we have anyone today visiting for the first time? If so, if yes, how to wave your hand. All right, all right. Got a couple. Got all right, we got some first timers. In the back, listen, do your very best, everybody. Make them feel welcome. Even though we have the protocols, the masks, we're trying to keep everybody safe, we still want you to know we love you and you're welcome. We want you to come back. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, well, our services are sort of short and modified because we try to get you in and out. We do everything possible to keep you safe. We're looking forward to that day when everything can kind of get back to close anyway to what it was. But we're leaving that in the good Lord's hand. Amen. All right. I was sort of look around. Now, we have a number of school administrators. I was trying to draft one to do the back to school prayer. And All right. I was trying to get Rashima say she just not praying. That's just she's not doing it. Amen. All right. All right. Where the rest of my school administrator? Wait a minute, Becky. I'll get to you if nobody else. All right. We have the brand new principal at Reddick Collier Elementary School who is here with us. Amen, 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 amen. Welcome to Marion County, and welcome to Reddick and Buzzard Roost and all those places up there. You know, her husband's with her, Brother Cooper. You're going to have to show her where Buzzard Roost is, you know. Because some of the kids will be coming out of Buzzard Roost and all that. And so forth. There are no buzzards there. He just got that name some kind of way. Brother Cooper may know. He's from up in that area. Would you come and pray for the return of school, for a blessing for our children, teachers, administrators, bus drivers, everybody? Would you just come and offer up a prayer? Please, ma'am. Thank you so much. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. The brand new principal over at Reddick Collier Elementary School.
First of all, I'd like to say thank God for the honor for you allowing me to do this at this moment. And I am a child of God. And I say I would not be where I'm at Reddick Collier if he hadn't done it.
He did
the promotion, not me. Let's bow our heads. Father God, we ask you right now. We ask that your grace and your mercy, it abides and rule over. And you said when you see the blood, anything that's not right will pass over. So, Father God, I ask you to let your blood just saturate every Marion County school, every bus driver, every administrator, every teacher, every para, every PE tech, every child, every parent, God. God, you said if we declare on earth, it'll be declared in heaven. So, God, we declare no loss of lives, no children sick and at home, no parents, no staff member, God, that you would declare the victory this school year, God, that we would know that you have been there and you have left your angels an assignment, God, and we would declare the glory for God. This is your season, your year, and we would say it is well, it is well, it is well in our souls. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. All right. All right. All right. Hallelujah. Yes. All right. I almost feel like going back to school. Almost. Almost. Not quite, but almost. Almost thou persuadest me to go back. I ain't going, though. Going. All right. Let's stand. Let's for our benediction. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sunday. Keep yourselves safe. May the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, the love of Christ rest, rule, and abide with thee now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful Sunday.
They were reading.